Okay, in the book of Revelation, chapter 15. This is a short chapter and a short sermon. You don't always believe that, do you? I heard a fellow today said, ain't going to keep you long. I think he's done a preaching there. Seemed like about an hour before he ended up. Let's take the time to pray. Father, it's a blessing to be here tonight. We thank you for grace. We thank you for mercy. We thank you for your love. We know we're not worthy of the least of your blessings, but we thank you for every blessing that you give us, and I pray that you'd help us tonight to be a blessing to your people. I pray that you'd lift us up and cause us to sit together in heavenly places, and so be glorified, be honored, be lifted up, and we'll thank and praise you in Jesus' sweet name. Amen, amen. The Bible said, who would not fear? Who would not fear the God of heaven? You wonder, who would not fear the Lord? So that's what he says in this chapter. But we see as we look through the book of Revelation, he's talked about the seven seals. He's taken us through the tribulation period in the seven seals, chapter 6. And then the seven trumpets, chapter 8, and also 9, and some in chapter 11. Then you have the seven personages, and of course you got the woman, you got the dragon, you got the man-child, you got 144,000, you got the Antichrist, you got the beast out of the earth, out of the land, and I wrote them down somewhere. Let's see, there's probably another two witnesses. And so there's seven personages that will take you through the tribulation period. Then the Bible talks about here the seven last plagues, the seven last plagues. The Bible said these are going to be the worst time of all history. Some people think it's already passed. There's been some horrible times in history. There's no question about it. The Holocaust with 6 million Jews put into gas chambers and treated the way they were treated. There was a whole lot more people died than that. There's something like 15 million people died through Hitler and what he did in World War Number 2. And so it's just not the Jews, but a lot of other people suffered and died as well. Well, the Bible talks about these signs. First sign was chapter number 12, verse 1. The woman was a sign, and that woman is Israel. It is not the church, as some people want to say. I don't understand how they can interpret the word of God that way, because the woman gives birth to the child. And Israel gave birth to the Savior, and of course the church does not give birth to the Savior, but the Savior gives birth to the church, right? And so I don't understand how they can come up with an interpretation like that. The second sign, the Bible said that, Revelation 12:3, is the great red dragon. That great red dragon, old Satan, standing there ready through the Roman Empire, ready to devour that child when he was born. And of course, Jesus caught up to the throne of God. Nothing is said about his life. He just caught up to the throne of God. We know that's the Lord Jesus. And then the third sign is right here in the book of Revelation, chapter 15. I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, seven angels having the seven last plagues, for in them is filled up the wrath of God. That's going to be a horrible time. That's going to be a time that men will seek to die and won't be able to die. They would to God they were already dead. And people say, well, the church is going through the tribulation period. Well, you just go on through it if you want to go through it. I want to be with Jesus, don't you? When the tribulation enters, the song says, we're going to be gone. When the tribulation's over, we're going to come back. And one fellow up in the mountains, he said, now how in the world are he going to bring all them church folks and how they're going to fit around Jerusalem? Well, you just take that up with God. I don't know how God made the universe. I don't know how he spoke me and you in existence. I don't know how he done a lot of things. And he can do it, can't he? I don't know how he made the water into wine. He just did it. He calmed the sea. He told the ocean, he said, peace be still. And it laid down like a dog. And so, he can do all that. They ain't no use to worry about it. God will take care of it when that time comes. And so it's a wonderful thing. Bible said, I saw as it were a sea of glass. And so when you think about this, you see, first of all, what John saw. Well, he was a witness. You know, a witness is a wonderful thing. And they have witnesses all the time in court and all that. They bring people up here and they want to know what they've seen. They want to know what they've experienced. And so they are a witness. And John said, I saw. And so again and again through the book of the Revelation, he says, I saw. And so he saw seven angels. Seven angels. Seven is a prime number in the book of the Revelation. It's God's number, the perfect number. It's amazing how many things are sevens. God gave us 7 days, didn't he? 7 days in a week. And so there's just a lot of sevens throughout the Word of God and throughout the universe. The Bible said he saw the sea of glass in verse number 2. And of course, that sea of glass is seen back in chapter number 4. Well, it's a type of the laver. You know that when the high priest, he went into the temple. I mean, at the tabernacle at first, there was the brazen altar where they made the sacrifice. And then there was the laver where they washed. And if you go over to Jerusalem and you go in that the mosque there on the mount, they got this big old fountain there. And you can sit down and wash your feet and wash your hands. I mean, they've got these seats. I don't know how big around it is. It's probably 20 or 30 feet around. They got seats. You can just sit right down, on them seats and wash your feet and wash your hands too. And so, hey, the laver's a type of washing and being clean. And, of course, the Bible said this sea of glass. And so here they are as it was the laver before the tabernacle. It speaks of purity. Speaks of holiness. And God wants us to be holy. And, of course, you have to be holy. The Bible said, the holy shall see God. The pure in heart are going to see God. If you're not pure in heart, you're not going to see him. So you got to be pure in the heart. You're going to be pure in heart. You got to have the blood of Jesus supplied. And so to go in his presence here, you got to go across that sea of glass. That's going to be something. The Bible said it was mingled with fire. Fire speaks of judgment, purification. And so, hey, God's going to purify his saints. God is so holy. The Bible said he's the only one that's holy. And then, isn't that going to be something? Well, the victory is gotten, the Bible said. They had the victory, verse number 2. They had the victory over the beast. They had the victory over his image. They have a victory over his mark. They had the victory over the number of his name. And so, hey, these people have put their faith in Jesus Christ, and they've overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. You know, the word of your testimony has a whole lot to do with a Christian life. Is stand up and give your testimony. Words do count. You know that? Words do count. And a lot of people, they deny the Lord Jesus. They deny him through their life. They deny him through their words. But he wants us to own him through our life and through our words to own him. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. The Bible said, they that believe on him will not be ashamed. And so when you get saved, you're not ashamed. And so it's a wonderful thing to be a testimony for Jesus every day. And so the Bible said we're more than conquerors through him that loved us. We're overcomers. The Bible talks about overcoming. And so we will overcome. You know why? Because we belong to him. We're going to overcome. We're victors through the name of Jesus Christ. The Bible said they have harps. What about that? They have harps and they're harping over there. And that's going to be something when we get to heaven. And of course, I don't know that I'll have a harp, but these folks have a harp because they've come through the tribulation period. They've overcome the beast and his image and all that. So they're going to have harps. What about that? They deserve to be able to sing and praise God, don't they? Well, one of these days we're going to be there around God's throne. Number 2, notice what they heard. They heard the singing, the song. The song of Moses. The song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. You go back to the book of Exodus and you find in chapter 15, when they crossed over the Red Sea, they begin to sing. They sang the song of victory. Hey, that's what it's going to be. It's going to be a song of victory, a song of praise. Turn back there just a few minutes and let's look at it just a second or two and think about, man, what a song they had and what victory they had, because God had done great things for them as they came across. They sang, then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I was singing the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. So they're singing to the Lord, and that's who we should sing to, right? Sing praise to his name. Sing glory to his name. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become a salvation. He is my God. I will prepare him a habitation, my Father's God, and I will exalt him. What about that? He's our strength. He's our God. He's our salvation. I will prepare him a habitation. How are you going to prepare God a habitation? In your heart, right? You prepare him a habitation in your heart. Boy, you let him come and live in your heart. Aren't you glad when you got saved he did come in and live? He came in, took up his abode in your heart and life. The Lord is a man of war. What about that? The Lord is his name. He's a man of war. He wars in righteousness, don't he? The Bible said Pharaoh and his chariots and his host hath he cast in the sea, his chosen captains, all that. This is verse 6. Thy right hand, O Lord, is to become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, hath dashed in pieces the enemy. In the greatness of thine excellency, thou hast overthrown them that rose up against thee. Thou sendest forth thy wrath, which consumed them as stubble. And with the blast of thy nostrils, the waters were gathered together. The flood stood upright as a heap, and the depths were congealed in the heart of the sea. Do you know what that's saying? God just blew his nose. He just blew his nose. This is how big God is. He just blew his nose, and a path was blowed out big enough for 3 million Jews to get across in one night. You imagine 3 million people trying to move in their flocks. They did have flocks, you know that. And so the wagons and whatever else they had to get across. And God blew out a path big enough for them to get across. He not only done that, but the Bible said he congealed the depths. Do you know what congeal means? Now, you women know what it means, don't you? You congeal that jello all the time, don't you? He froze that mud in the bottom of that ocean. I mean, that sea. He froze it. Now, what about that? He said, stand still, Moses. He said, stretch out that rod. He stretched it out, and blessed be God, he blew his nose. The Bible said the breath of his nostrils. Ain't that your nose? And the Bible said he congealed the depths. They went across. They didn't have no problem. Didn't mire up in the mud, because, you know, it would be mud in a sea like that, wouldn't it? But he congealed it, so they walked right across. Hey, do you know what kind of God we're serving tonight? You have any idea how big God is? Well, we'll not go down through all this song, but hey, the Bible said they're going to sing this song. It's a song of praise. It's a song of victory, and that's what they're going to sing. And hey, that's what we're going to sing. We get there too, isn't it? We're going to sing the victor song. Hey, we're not going to sing any sad songs up in heaven. We're not going to sing, Lord, build me a cabin. Going to glory land. Ain't going to be no cabins up there, brother. Everything he builds is big. He's big. He's a big God. Brother George and Marcia bought him a house over on the way there. I don't know what to call that over there. But it's a pretty good-sized little house. And George, he's a big man. He likes big things, don't you, George? He likes big things. And I said, well, that's the way folks are. It's big. They like big things. And God's a big God, isn't he? He likes big things, and heaven's going to be big. The universe is big. Everything is big. Oh, glory to God. I'm telling you, we're going to have a time we get to heaven. The Bible says it's going to be the song of Moses, not the Lamb. Do you know Jesus is a singer? Do you have any idea that Jesus is a singer? He is. He's the singer. The Bible said in the book of Hebrews, saying, I would declare thy name unto my brethren. That's what he did when he came. He came to declare the Lord's name, his Father's name to the brethren. And in the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee. Jesus is going to lead the choir, brother. He's going to lead the church. When we get to heaven, imagine all that great multitude, and Jesus is going to lead us in a song of praise and victory. Hallelujah. Can we just stop and shout a while and say, glory, glory, glory. I mean, you talk about a song leader. You talk about a singer. Blessed be God. I wish I could sing, but I can't. I believe old Lucifer, the son of the morning, I think he was a choir leader. The Bible said, your pipes are in you. I believe that he was a singer. Because you know what? The devil gets in singing more than anything else about in church, don't he? Singers are jealous. Well, preachers get jealous too, don't they? That's two things that gets jealous, you know, preachers and singers. And so, hey, you know what? We're all in the same business for the same God. We're going to the same heaven. And one day, brother, he's going to pay off. And God don't pay off on Friday, but he will pay off. And God pays off in 10,000%. So, hallelujah. Just keep working for Jesus. Keep your eyes on him. Don't get sidetracked, because that devil, he wants to sidetrack you, don't he? He wants to sidetrack him. So they are singing, and Jesus is a singer. The devil, I believe, Lucifer was a singer. Notice what they're saying in verse number 3. They're saying, and they sing the song of Moses and the servant of God and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Well, is his works, what they said, marvelous are thy works? I marvel at God's works, don't you? I marvel at God's creation. I really do. I mean, you know, when I was a little old boy, I'd shoot the birds and shoot it. I tried to kill them crows, but they was always smarter than I was. You know, they had a watcher always watching. And they'd see you coming, and they'd go, hey, quack, 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 and the rest of them, they'd fly off, you know. Well, I could kill them at my house because they fly in there and eat. But you know what? When I become a Christian, Lord, I begin to realize this is God's creation. And I'm amazed as I watch God's creation. And you see them little old creatures and how they do. Them little old creatures. I was watching that little old ground squirrel out there. He comes squirreling around here. And boy, he shoots like that across there. I guess he's afraid a hawk's going to get him. And he'll maneuver around like that. And I have seen him run up the tree. I didn't even know ground squirrels would run up a tree, but he did. And he wasn't as good as them gray squirrels, though. He didn't know which limb to go out to jump. I was watching a little old squirrel this evening. He was a-jumping about 3 or 4 foot. Shh, about 3 or 4 foot, he was a-jumping and going through the trees and the limbs. God's creation is just amazing. It's amazing. It's amazing. Here's them old hawks, and here's them old eagles. They're up here 200 or 300 feet, 500 feet. And you know what? They can see them things down on the ground. I can just barely see you folks at the back. No, I see a little better than that. But anyway, isn't that amazing? I mean, his works are wonderful and glorious, and what he does, it's marvelous. You look at your body, that's amazing, isn't it? You look at your hands, isn't that amazing? The hand is what a machine it is. What that hand can do. Your eyes, they're amazing. Brother Kenneth Ridings used to talk about how many pictures your eyes could take, perfect pictures. You know, there's not a camera made, I don't think, is as good as your eyes. Because I can focus on every one of y'all, and I don't have to focus on Larry and focus on Sib and focus on Miss Chapman back there. I can just focus on every one of them by looking at you. But that camera won't do that. You shoot that camera up here, and these folks are blurry back here. So you got to focus on them, and then these blurry up here. But that camera, it's amazing. And, hey, they're colored pictures, too. What about that? I mean, isn't God a marvelous God? What about your ears? God made your ears. You know that crazy thing they said, a tree falls, nobody hears it. They don't make no sound. Hey, I said, they're crazy. God hears it. The angel hears it. Hey, the creatures out there in the woods, they hear it. But they come up with all this baloney, don't they? Well, your body is amazing. It's a marvelous work. Your body, we are wonderfully and marvelously made, the Bible said. And so, boy, your body is a wonderful creation. It sure is. So he's hearing them say the works of God, the works of God. And then he said the ways of God. What about that? He says, just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. His ways are just. Whatever God does is just. Now, I can't say people's like that. Because, brother, if you deal with people, you're going to find some of them not just. And some of them are not true either, are they? True are his ways. Where do you find God's ways at? You find them in the Bible, right? You find God's ways in the Bible. That's the reason you need to read the Bible. Read the Bible, read the Bible. Somebody asked me a question this morning. They went out of the vestibule out there. They asked me a question which revealed to me they had never read the book of Genesis. It's amazing what you can find out when people just open their mouth, ain't it? He wanted to know about the tongues, you know. He had heard Preacher Stanley. Did he preach on that this morning? He might have preached some other time about the tongues at the Tower of Babel. And did he preach on that this morning? And so he was asking me about that. And I said, well, it's in the book of Genesis. And evidently he had never read that. He said, well, I never heard of that. I didn't know anything about that. Well, see, you skin your ignorance, don't you? But not reading. Read the Word of God. Read the Word of God. You find out all that. Where do you find the ways of God? You find it in the Bible. You find it in prayer. You find it in the church. You find it through the Holy Spirit. You find the ways of God. God reveals himself. It's amazing what people that go to church know and what the world don't know. When you listen to these talk shows, you know good and well they don't know anything about God. They don't know anything about the Bible. I'm glad I know the truth, and the truth is way up here, and they're way down there. You say you're better than them. No, but I'm saved and know Jesus Christ. And that's a wonderful thing to know the Savior and to live for him. He said, who would not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name? Who would not fear the living God? I mean, a man is a fool. He's a fool. The Bible said the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. The fool has said, no God, I'm not going to believe in you. I'm not going to trust in you. I've told you the story about old B.R. Lincoln riding on the airplane, and he had a Bible, and that fellow beside him said, do you believe that? He said, yeah, I believe that. He said, well, I don't believe that. He said, well, I saw your name in there. The old fellow said, you ain't seen my name in there. Oh, yeah, I did. The fool has in his heart, there is no God. I wonder what that fellow said then, don't you? Oh, yes. Who would not fear thee, O Lord? Who would not fear the God of heaven? Oh, man will fear in that day. They'll cry and they'll beg God for mercy, but there'll be no mercy in that day. Today, God is a God of mercy. I'm glad there's mercy at the cross. There's mercy when you come to Christ. There's mercy, there's forgiveness, there's love, there's life when you come to Christ. But one day, it'll be too late. Brother Mike came in the hallway door about the time we was coming out of the prayer room, and somebody says, too late. You're too late. Sometimes we're all too late, ain't we, on things. But hey, to be too late to serve God is an awful thing. He said, but he goes on to say, for thou art holy, only holy. You're the only one that's holy. You know God's the only one that's holy. He is the only one that's holy. We are made holy through the blood of Jesus. But brother, I mean, we are far from what God is. He's a holy God. He's without sin. He's never had any sin, never will have any sin. He's true and righteous in all of his ways. For all nations shall come and worship before thee, for all thy judgments are made manifest. Man alive, that's what you find in the book of the Revelation. His judgments are made manifest. His plagues will be poured out. And when the plagues are poured out, it's going to be an awful time. Let me just give you a few things and I'll close. A plague is an epidemic. It includes pestilence and calamity and the judgment of God. It includes affliction. It includes trouble and all that. There is the plague of leprosy the Bible talks about in Leviticus 13. If no sin, there would be no disease. You know that? If there was no sin, there wouldn't be no disease. That's amazing. There's a plague at Kibroth Hattaavah in Numbers chapter 11, verse 33. The wrath of God fell on them while the meat was between their teeth. They said, we want meat, we want meat. We're tired of these. This man of God said, hey, okay, I'll give you meat. And he gave it to them till it's running out their mouth and their ears. And the Bible said, while it was still between their teeth, the plague came upon them. There's the plague of the 10 spies in Numbers chapter 14 and verse 37, because they came back and discouraged the hearts of the people. Don't ever discourage a Christian. Don't ever discourage a young Christian. Let them go. Let them run like a wild horse. Let them go, because, hey, they'll find out if there's anything out there. Don't discourage a Christian. Don't discourage the work of God. There's the plagues on a complaining congregation. Numbers chapter 16 and 14,700 died because it's complaining. That's what God thinks about complaining and belly aching. Be careful about that complaining, belly aching, because you might get the plague of God on you. The Bible said there was a plague of Baal Peor, and God killed 24,000 because of that plague. Balaam, you know, gave them the wrong information. He said the wrong counsel. He said, well, I can't curse them, but if you'll invite them over here to these sex orgies, the curse of God will get on them. Yeah, it did work, sure did. But it cost old Balaam, didn't it? Balaam said, let me die like old Jacob did. Let my last end be like his. I want to die like Jacob. How'd Jacob die? He died blessing his sons and leaned upon his staff and worshiped God, because God has spoken through him as a prophet. Laid down that bed and said, goodbye, I'll see you in the morning. Who wouldn't want to die like that? But is that the way Balaam died? No, he died from the sword of an Israeli. That's how he died. He did not get his wish, because he was a soothsayer and he gave the wrong advice. There's the plague upon the Philistines when they carried the ark of God down in the land of the Philistines. God put a plague on them. They had hemorrhoids, tumors. They carried it around from place to place, and the judgment of God came on them every place they took it. They said, take that thing back. Take it back to Israel. We're tired of God's judgments on us. And they said, well, we'll see if it's God or not, if it's just chance. Said, put it on a cart. Take two fresh cows. They just had calves. Most of you don't know what that means, do you? But I do because I was raised on a farm. I was raised around cattle. And you take a cow and she has a calf, and you take her out of the stall, she'll hang around all day at the bar mooing. She wants to get in there where that calf is. And they said, we'll take these two fresh cows and we'll hook them this ark and this cart, and we'll put the ark of God on it. And if it goes toward Israel, we'll know that it's God. If it's, if they take off around here, we'll know it just chance. And guess what happened? They put that ark on that cart. Them old cows started up there, moo, 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 moo. But they kept going toward the land of Israel. They didn't want to go, but they went anyway because God had his hand upon them. That's why. Oh, yes, and then they knew it was the plague of God. There's the plague. That Beth-Shemesh, when they got up there, and the fellows out in the field, they run over there and grab the ark of God off of that cart and set it on a rock. And these men, they wanted to see what was in that ark, and they opened the ark of God. And you don't put your hand on holy things. And when they did, 50,070 men died when they opened the ark of God. Whew. God mean business, folks. He's not playing. God's a holy God. There's a plague of numbering the people. David wanted to know how many warriors he had, how many people he had. And Joab said, you don't need to know that. Look at how God is blessed and what he's done. And David said, I want to know. And so they numbered the people. And the judgment of God fell. A plague was put upon them because of that. 70,000 people died. And David said, oh, God, put it on me. It's me, Lord, it's me. And he said, go and offer a sacrifice. And that's where God gave him the place to put the temple. What about that? There's the plague of Jehoram. The Bible said his bowels dropped out, fell out. That'd be a horrible plague, wouldn't it? 2 Chronicles chapter 21. There's the plague of the tribulation period. The Bible said it's going to be chemical warfare. The Bible says in the book of Zechariah chapter 14 and 12, and this shall be the plague whereof the Lord will smite all the people that have fought against Jerusalem. They've come up to fight against Jerusalem, and listen what God's done, and their flesh shall consume away while they stand upon their feet. Their eyes shall consume away in their holes, and their tongue shall consume away in their mouth. Now how'd you like that? Your eyes consume away, just melt. Your tongue will melt in your mouth because you came to fight against God's people, Jerusalem. That's chemical warfare, I believe. I don't know about you, but I believe they'll be using that stuff in the tribulation period. And so shall the plague of the horse and the mule and the camel and the ass and all the beasts that shall be in these tents as this plague. So all the horses and mules and everything else. There's the plague of the millennials. The Bible said it shall come to pass that every nation that's left which came against Jerusalem shall even go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep the feast of the tabernacle. If they don't come, you know what they get? They don't get no rain. The plague, no rain. Oh, yes. God controls everything, don't he? He controls the elements. He controls the storm. He said, peace be still. Turn water to wine. Multiply the fish and the bread. Now, there was that little woman had the plague of the issue of blood in the book of Mark chapter 5. There's the plague. Her plague was staged. She said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I believe I'll be made whole. Hey, whatever you can believe God for, he can do. Our problem is we don't believe. Our problem is unbelief. Well, I said, we know God can do it, but will God do it? We got to believe he will. There's the plague of Abraham's day in Genesis chapter 12. There's the 10 plagues in Egypt. There's the plague of Jerusalem. I will make this place desolate. There's the plague of Edom. Edom shall be desolate. There's the plague of Babylon, Jeremiah 50:13. It shall be wholly desolate. The plague of the infirmities in Jesus' day were healed. The Bible said they were healed of their plagues. There's the plague of the two witnesses. The Bible said they have power to smite the earth. That the plagues as often as they will. They have the power to put plagues upon this earth. Here's the plagues of the seven trumpets. We'll see it in just probably the next time with me. Let's stand. Father, I want to thank you tonight for the good word of God. We love you, Lord Jesus, because you loved us and because you've given us the word here that we know what's going to happen in days to come, so we can live for you, so we can love you, so we can believe you, so we can put our trust in you. Help us to be a light for Jesus every day. Help us to shine. You said to let your light shine. God, help us to be a light to a dying world. Help us to be a witness. Help us to love people and to a witness to them and to lead them to Christ. God, bless Zion Baptist Church. Keep your hand upon this church. Keep the power of God moving in this church, we pray. Lord, move, and do mighty things. Move upon the Jubilee. Oh, God, we pray that your light will shine from this place. Oh, God, let it shine brighter and brighter as the days go by, and we'll praise and say thank you in Jesus' name. Might be somebody here tonight. You need to come around these altars. If you've got a burden, got a care, got a need, if you're not saved, you can get saved. If you're out of fellowship with God, you can get back in tune with God. Whatever you need. If you need joy, there's joy. There's forgiveness in this house. There's healing in this house. There's great things in this house. You know why? Because God is in the house. I'm glad God's in the house. You say, how do you know? Because he lives in me.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, all the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
road I travel has its ups and downs, but I know I'm heaven bound as I journey here below. Even if I'm on a mountain tall, I'll soon surpass it all at the end of the glory road. I'm gonna rise a whole lot higher than this mountain that I'm on. My sights are set on glory, where I'll sing a brand new song. I'm going to kneel at the feet of Jesus when I come before his throne at the end of the glory road. I'm learning every day to trust in him, even when the path grows dim, still he's leading me, I know. Jesus seems to whisper in my ear that heaven is so near at the end of the glory road. I'm gonna rise a whole lot higher than this mountain that I'm on. My sights are set on glory, where I'll sing a brand new song. I'm gonna kneel at the feet of Jesus when I come before his throne at the end of the glory road. I'm gonna rise a whole lot higher than this mountain that I'm on. My sights are set on glory, where I'll sing a brand new song. I'm gonna kneel at the feet of Jesus when I come before his throne at the end of the glory road. I'm learning every day to trust in him, Even when the path grows dim, still he's leading me, I know. Jesus seems to whisper in my ear that heaven is so near at the end of the glory road. I'm gonna rise a lot higher than this mountain that I'm on. My sights are set on glory, where I'll sing a brand new song. I'm gonna kneel at the feet of Jesus when I come before his throne at the end of the glory road. I'm gonna rise a whole lot higher than this mountain that I'm on. My sights are set on glory, where I'll sing a brand new song. I'm gonna kneel at the feet of Jesus when I come before his throne at the end of the glory road. I'm gonna kneel at the feet of Jesus when I come before his throne at the end of the glory road.
Of the glory road.
Glory road.
Glory road.
Glory road.
Glory road.
Glory road.
Now this is just a good old Southern gospel song. If you guys know it, join in and sing it with us tonight, okay?
There's a city, a beautiful city, just beyond the divide, where God's children shall rest eternal, they will ever abide. Daily striving to reach that homeland, we are going that way. Heading for glory, telling the story, we shall see heaven someday.
Someday,
someday, we shall see Jesus someday by and by.
Someday,
someday, these eyes shall behold him in that city on high. We must not linger, we must keep moving, Jesus is leading the way. Shouting and singing, joy bells ringing, we shall see heaven someday.
Like the saints who have gone before us, we're determined to stay in the path that is straight and narrow, leading us forward each day. Though we have problems, Jesus is faithful, all our needs to supply. The time is now nearing for his appearing, for our heavenly flight.
Someday by and by,
someday,
someday, these eyes shall behold him in that city on high. We must not linger, we must keep moving, Jesus is leading the way. Shouting and singing, joy bells ringing, we shall see heaven someday.
Someday,
someday, we shall see Jesus someday by and by.
Someday,
someday, these eyes shall behold him in that city on high. We must not linger, we must keep moving, Jesus is leading the way. Shouting and singing, joy bells ringing, we shall see heaven someday. We must not linger, we must keep moving, Jesus is leading the way. Shouting and singing, joy bells ringing, we shall see heaven someday. We shall see heaven someday.
Darkest hour the world had ever seen, watching the death of the king. The crucifixion brought such sorrow and pain, crushing all their hopes and dreams. But at the dawning of the third day, when they came unto the tomb, there was a newness in the air and an angel standing there to tell them the good news.
There's been a resurrection. Don't you be afraid.
The Redeemer liveth.
When they saw him on that day, all the doubts and fears vanished. Jesus rose from the grave.
They had to go and tell
he was alive and well. There'd been a resurrection.
You know, Jesus, when he went to the cross, he went to the cross for the whole world. The problem is, it's not the, they don't always accept him, right? But if you've accepted him as your Lord and Savior, you too can be resurrected with Jesus Christ to live with him forever.
Though the world lies in darkness, still the light that I can see, the power of his resurrection, it made a promise to me. And that same spirit that raised Jesus, it quickened me one day. For I was dead in my sins, now I'm alive in him, and I can truly say,
there's been a resurrection. I am not afraid.
My Redeemer liveth.
I shall see him on that day. All my doubts and fears vanish. Jesus rose from the grave.
I have to go and tell
he is alive and well. There's been a resurrection.
I say I have to go and tell
he is alive and well. There's been a resurrection. Been a resurrection. There's been a resurrection.